Regarding atomic fusion, we will now have some hands-on examples from Mr. Atomic Fusion.
Please welcome on stage Martin Fitzel.
Welcome. Hello? Hello and welcome. I'm still Martin. I'm still a backend developer at Zeitgeist, and I still like to tell front-end developers how to do their job. At Zeitgeist, we use Atomic Fusion every day for every NEOS project, whether it's big or it's small. It does not matter. It's nothing we think about anymore. It's just the way we work. So today, I want to share with you the patterns we use for that and give you a basis, name patterns, to talk about such stuff in the future. I have two objectives for this talk. At first, I want to get you started. If you never use Atomic Fusion again, I will show you the patterns you need to create your first content nodes with Atomic Fusion to understand the concept of presentational components. But even if you are already working with Atomic Fusion, I will show you things that you are probably already doing, but I will try to put proper names on them so we can later on talk about that more efficiently. So I hope, even if you are already using Atomic Fusion, you can take something away from here. Be warned, there's lots of code ahead, and of course, I want to show you all you need to get started, not only the nice parts. So if you're not into Fusion coding, you can visit David. He is surely talking about something really interesting. I would like to hear it. But if you're into Fusion, stay here and, yeah, you were warned. hands-on examples, but first let's start with some definitions. One thing is AFX. I will talk about AFX a lot, or no, I will not talk about it. I will take it as granted. AFX was introduced at the NEOS conference 1 year ago by me and Wilhelm Behnke. Back then it was a prototype. And AFX is a compact syntax for Fusion, especially optimized for writing presentational Fusion code. AFX is inspired by JSX, which is known from the React universe. And internally, AFX is transpiled into Fusion code like this. After the transpiling, the resulting Fusion code is parsed, cached, and whenever a request hits the server, it's evaluated. So AFX is Fusion. Internally, it is the same. It's just better readable for presentational code. There is no difference. AFX is strictly optimized for writing the rendering side of your code to be as easy and declarative as possible. So while Fusion already is declarative, it is for rendering code not that readable before. With AFX, it gets that. And AFX can be used without Atomic Fusion. We do not do that, but I know some people do, and it is definitely not needed to use Atomic Fusion if you're using AFX. To me, AFX makes Fluid completely obsolete. Your mileage may vary, but I don't need Fluid anymore. I think it's kind of an anti-pattern. And since AFX is Fusion, it eliminates jumping back and forth between the Fusion runtime and the Fluid template engine, which happens a lot in classic NEOS. So since AFX is Fusion, it has no negative runtime effects. Fusion has always been the layer who triggered the rendering, who cached the results, and since it does not have to call Fluid anymore to perform its job, it's not slower. I didn't notice any much performance gain, but the performance is quite the same. So AFX has been a prototype 1 year ago, but in December it moved to the NEOS namespace. So it's an official NEOS project now, and you can require it via Composer. And you should definitely check it out, even if you decide not to use Atomic Fusion for your project, but if you're creating rendering code, you should give it ASX a shot and try to get rid of fluid. Next term, this atomic fusion thingy. Atomic fusion is not atomic design. That first, and it was also introduced 1 year ago at this NEOS conference. And atomic fusion refers to two different things. First, you may note there was a package called atomic fusion. Some of you used it in projects, and this package brought some fusion prototypes. The most important one was the component that encapsulated rendering, but also there was an augmenter to modify already rendered code and some components to integrate it nicely into the NEOS backend. But those prototypes are, or now these prototypes were in an external package back then. Right now they are in the Fusion core or in the NEOS. Parts of them are in the Fusion core, some in the NEOS core, but they are official now. You can still use the package factory Atomic Fusion, but you don't have to anymore. Those prototypes were just tools. So while this package is called Atomic Fusion, this package was just created to implement the principles I think are important for Atomic Fusion, and the two most important ones are a strict separation of the rendering, or what we call it presentation, from the integration side, which is responsible to fetch the data that is actually rendered, while the presentation side is responsible for all the markup, all the styles, and have an API in between. And another important principle is the isolation of the rendering side to be side effect free. So a component only takes its input, it does only rely on the input it is given, it does not use any domain logic internally. Atomic fusion is an advanced concept for writing fusion code, so it probably is not the ideal paradigm you want to use if you're writing your first content node or a content type, but it is no overkill, it's just making things more efficient, and it has its benefits when you're maintaining a code base over time and when you're having a complex front end which has to be where you want to apply changes, where you want to reuse your components and fill them with data that comes from somewhere else, and you probably will not know where the data originates from when you're writing the component. If you get familiar with Atomic Fusion, you will use it almost everywhere for big projects, but also for small ones. Zeitgeist is not the only agency that uses Atomic Fusion. I heard about quite a lot of agencies which already use it, and even more who think about it. So you're not alone if you try it. And given the number of people who seem to use it already, we have very little requests and hear about very few problems with it. So enough terms. Let's start with patterns. And I will start first with the presentation side. And the single most important pattern on the presentation side is a presentational component. It's quite trivial, but it's really important to get this right. A presentational component isolates the visual aspects for the rendering of a data structure. And this includes all aspects, markup, styling, and also the scripts. And a presentational component in general looks like this. It has two main parts. The first is the API. This is the data the component expects, and the second one is the renderer that defines what the component will output. The data that is passed via API can be used in the renderer as props, and the term props is best understood as kind of movie props, the thing you give an actor when he enters the stage. You don't expect him to change it. He will use it, he will show it to the audience, but he will not change it. So it's movie props, it's not properties. The presentational component has another important job. It also isolates the styling and the scripts, and to do that, the Fusion code is co-located with the CSS and the JS files. So one folder isolates the generation of markup, the styles needed for this markup, and also the JS needed to perform the job. Everything except the external API is a secret of the presentational component. So whenever front-end developer decides to change the inner working of a presentational component, he is free to do so. He did not promise you anything. He promised you to react to these props. Because it's so important, again, the definition, I read it yesterday already. Presentational components encapsulate the visual aspects for the representation of a data structure. This includes the generation of markup, styling, and interaction. Presentational components are side effect free, but may rely on other presentational components to perform their job. So that's presentational components. The second pattern, still quite trivial, is composition. We have composition when presentational components use other presentational components, and by doing so, we create higher order components. Or no, the term is wrong. It's from the JS world. But one component uses another component and passes down props. That's how the code looks. You see that there is an additional prop image theory, and it is passed to an image component internally. So not that complicated. The API, as long as the API stays the same, the component may use another component to perform the job. So still quite simple. A pattern you will see quite often is that a component has some variation. So you don't know yet. It is a thing, it is the same, but it exists in various ways. And to do so, a very simple way is to introduce some flags. And flags are props which expect some Boolean values. And in this case, I show a headline component which has a special flag. And it will use in the renderer this special prop to add another class. And the interesting fact is that the case that this component decides to add the BEM class headline bold is a secret of the component. The component exposes that it is able to render a special headline. What it does internally is the secret of a presentational component. Still trivial. Sometimes it gets more complicated, so you can add dozens of flags to presentational components, but will not be much fun to work with it, especially if you are creating things like you have an item where an editor may change between a dozen of layouts. So in that case, you might consider to use a modifier. And a modifier is usually a string, which is mostly optional. And in this case, this modifier is used to create a BEM modifier class for this component. And by doing so, you easily run into the situation that you don't know what to expect anymore. So this component takes a modifier, but it by default would not say what modifier can be handled, what will be done. So if you're doing that, you should at least document in any way what modifiers are supported. Or like in the example, you should make it sure somehow. What I am doing here, I'm using the prop types package to decide that the modifier may only be of the value bold or italic, and any other value which is passed as modifier will raise an exception in the development context. So there are ways, and you should make sure that there is a definition which can be understood from the outside what service a presentational component provides. So this is kind of the documentation you're giving the integrator who will later on use this component to perform his job. Sometimes you will find presentational components which have to behave different or have to look different in a very specific context. And adding more modifiers or more flags to a component is not always the right option. Sometimes, like with the image, you're not changing the child, you're just painting some ink on it. So What we call this pattern is augmentation. And it's done like this. In this example, I have a teaser list, which renders a teaser. But in the context of this teaser list, the teaser gets some additional data, which may be used by some JS filtering, and also gets an additional class. And the prototype which is done to do this internally is the Neos Fusion Augmenter. And the Neos Fusion Augmenter will render the content internally, in this case, the teaser molecule again, and add attributes to the rendered content. So if you have a thing that needs to be altered in a specific context, you can use this pattern. And the interesting thing is that the inner working, what the data attributes are doing and what the teaser list item class is actually doing, is now a secret of the teaser list component. So the teaser does not care about that. He is doing what he always does. And the teaser list is responsible to react to the data attributes to add the JavaScript that will do the right thing and contain the CSS for the teaser list item. The next pattern is simple but very useful. I call it conditional tag name. And it's mostly used for optional links, but can be used in other cases as well. And quite common is it if you are creating things like buttons in the backend, where you have to inline edit the text on the button and do not want the editor to jump away or something like that. So what we are doing here is that we are not writing directly a tag in the AFX syntax, but we are using the Neos Fusion tag prototype and make the tag name an expression and decide when there is a link passed as prop, then an A tag gets rendered, otherwise it's a span. So very useful in the backend, and still it's totally presentation code. It does not decide whether this code is executed in the backend or in the frontend. It just reacts to whether there's a link or not. So this pattern is still only depending on the props. The next pattern I call optional section. And it is used to render or to skip parts of the rendering when parts of the data structure are missing or match certain conditions or do not. So the interesting thing is we borrowed the addIf annotation from Fusion. It was already there. So in that case, we are doing things that are not possible in JSX. And by doing so, we can define a condition that has to match that this H2 section will be rendered. So you can easily create parts of your presentational component that are optional, and that way avoid creating various presentational components for header blocks that have one or two lines. So that's not necessary, and that's not actually very much logic. That's the kind of logic I still accept in a presentational component. I do not recommend to add more logic, so like case statements or things like that. You might try to write it in AFX, but that's not the right way to use it. It feels cumbersome, and you should listen to that. Now let's get to more interesting parts. And the pattern I want to show you now is called a collection. And sometimes you want to create a component that takes a list of items of a specific type and do something. And like you see here, we pass a bunch of eggs to a component and expect an omelet. And just to give you an example, it would be not be clever to pass some chickens to a component, because there are still some very domain-specific tasks necessary to get eggs from the chickens to create an omelet. But if you already have eggs, it's quite easy to create an omelet from that. So it is OK to expect that from a presentational component. So that's just to make the distinction clear. What kind of data can you pass to presentational components? Lists of items are perfectly fine. So how is this rendered? In this example, the component expects a list of items to render a slider. And To iterate over the slider, the component uses the NEOS Fusion collection prototype and pass the items which were received as props to this prototype. Important at this stage is the add children annotation, since NEOS Fusion collection needs an item renderer, and to actually get the children of the collection tag passed to the item renderer fusion property, you have to add this annotation. So it's not exactly nice, but it works totally and is very important if you're rendering data structures. And this pattern is also applied to render menus. So when I render a menu, I will usually pass a list of items which contain each a URL and a title. The last pattern for the presentational site I want to show you is called container. And sometimes you do not really care about the data you pass to a component. So if you have some X, it's okay. But if you have things like an accordion, you just mainly want to put an HTML blob into that. So the component does not really care about what it gets as input and should just give it out, show it again. And that's pretty much the same a container does. A container does not care what you put into it. It will just keep the doors closed. And if you look into it again half a year later, you probably will find the same things again. How is that implemented? Yeah, trivial. But what is important is that you can only, if you do that, you have to make sure that you will not pass generic HTML into an attribute or something like that. So you should output the content only as between tags. And what you should also think about is naming the props that accepts the content or the HTML block content, since this enables you quite easily to use the component in AFX, which will pass all the child contents automatically as content prop to the children. The distinction between container and collection is not always that easy in the beginning, so that's why I wanted to give you the images to remember whether you really want a collection of items or a container, since you will have to decide on that later on quite often. As you have noticed, I talked quite a bit about component APIs, and defining APIs is never really easy. And I want to show you some simple hints to keep as reminder to be able to define nice or to learn to define nice APIs. There's much experience involved, so don't expect to get it right in the first place. So what are good tips for presentational APIs? Of course, first, use simple values wherever possible and use meaningful names. Naming things is one of the hard problems, but yeah, be careful. Really think about using content if you are creating a component that accepts HTML blobs, since it makes using it in AFX really easy. And if you have to pass complex data, you can pass collections, which are arrays of items. And you can pass hash maps, which are arrays with named keys. Totally sucks that PHP doesn't make a distinction between them. But you should be careful. But those are valid properties as well. But you should never, never, ever pass domain objects to presentational components. So no assets, no nodes. Instead, you usually will convert these assets to URLs or other things beforehand from the outside. So a component expects to get simple types, presentational component. Just a rule of thumb. This obviously means, what would JSON do? So if you have a nice way to represent the API of your component in JSON, it probably is a good API. Think about that from time to time. And yeah, that's for the APIs. We have some tools to make working with presentational components easier. And the most obvious one is monocle. You see on me as well. And what it does, it takes a presentational component and uses some data you already written with source code to render it for you without any integration steps. So there is no node type, no backend, no user data involved, just the code you've written together with the StyleGuide annotation. And you can look at your code, you can use other components to see what the total result will be. And definitely a worthy step. And you can test this before you hand it over to the backend and integration department. So that is an important tool for front-end developers to create presentational components on their own and to review them together with project managers or with customers even before they are passed to the backend department. It's open source. You can get it via GitHub and via Composer. So check it out if you're using presentational components. And to use Monocle, you have to write presentational components, since Monocle will not have the content repository or the understanding of a site on nodes when the components are actually rendered. So you cannot simply add StyleGuide annotations to non-presentational components. That will just raise errors. And it's intended to be that way. The second recommendation for tools is prop types. I already showed this example some time ago. And while the StyleGuide annotation already is kind of a documentation how a component wants to be used or can be used, it is not really explicit. It is not enforcing anything. It's more like a suggestion. And prop types are also a concept from the JavaScript world, and prop types are much stricter. So via prop types, you can exactly define what kind of value you expect for a given key, and you can also define whether it's required or not. And given the settings you have, prop types will raise an exception if the definitions are not matched. Usually it does this only in development context, so in production context, prop types is not even applied. It is implemented as an aspect of the component prototype. And in development context, it will check the data that is rendered, and in production context, it will just do nothing and let Fusion perform its job. And Fusion usually tries to be silent whenever there is something stupid and show nothing and do as much as it can without much complaining. Maybe it locks something, but usually Fusion will not complain. So that's why you probably want prop types in your development environment, to actually see errors when you are passing things to components which may not be expected. So it's also open source. You can require it via Composer. And yeah, check it out and try whether you want, or think about whether you want to make the interface of your components more explicit and more enforcing. The next important aspect I want to talk about is structuring the namespace of your components. It's a topic that I have to discuss quite often. And many people think about, yeah, well, we are using atomic design. And usually that's not the case, since atomic design is not a namespace structure. Atomic design is a design ideology. And it's a principle that creates a design by starting from the smallest components and creating bigger components by aggregating them to bigger fragments. Those fragments are then called molecules, organisms, and templates, and there's much discussion whether a fragment is a molecule, an organism. I never found a proper definition, so don't ask this question later on. There is no, it does not make sense. But the most important part, you cannot expect to use the namespaces atomic design proposes and expect that it works properly if your underlying layout does not really follow those principles. So if you try to map a layout on an atomic architecture and the layout did not really work that way, you will only find the inconsistency of the layouts and probably end up discussing the layout with the designer. So your button in this case does not follow your design principle. Huh? Developer is explaining the designer what the design principle is. It's not really, I think it should not be that way. So forcing an atomic design namespace on an existing layout that follows a totally different paradigm is not really a good idea. So you can use the namespace of atomic design if you want, if it helps you, if the other developers you work with expect it that way, understand it that way, but do not expect it to be totally consistent and do not expect to match the layout in any case. So be prepared to make some compromises. That's why I suspect, or I suggest, that you use your method. And the best method that you can use is a method that helps you to describe the layout intention. So the component structure you create for your project should express the intention of the layout for the designer. To do that, you have to sit together with the designer and understand the meaning and then implement it. And that's what Atomic Fusion really allows us. It allows us to implement a layout intention. So that's definitely not easy, and you will get closer to it, not in the first project, but maybe in the third or the fourth project, but you can iterate, get better. And I think in the end, when you're working together with the same designers more often, you will find ways and you will get more efficient to communicate about the design systems. The designers are usually not used to explain their design systems to developers, so they will kind of be surprised if you start asking questions how the design layout really works. But it's totally worth it. And a systematic way to get to this is called the snowflake method. And that this method kind of turns the principle of atomic design around, and it starts from the top. So you take a layout, and you sit together with the designer, and you start splitting the layout into larger chunks, and you name them together. So what you get is a common understanding what component is called in what way, what do you expect, is it a slider, is it a gallery. So later on you can refer quite easy if the designer will say, yeah, you have to make the gallery more fancy. You will immediately know what he refers to. So there will not be the situation anymore that the implementation in the front end calls a component totally different than the designer or the project manager or the customer. It's really important to do this naming, splitting things down into smaller parts, and then if you have larger parts, split them again, but not until you reach atoms. So of course, it may make sense to split some things down to atoms, but it's important that you stop in the moment when you reach the granularity that makes sense for you. So if you don't need things to be reused in other components, you can leave it in the molecule or in a higher order component, and just start extracting smaller components if you need them in some other places. So be pragmatic, and yeah, I said talk to designers. And of course, you can use parts of the atomic design as namespace structure. Many designers are used to talk that way. Many developers are used to think about, is this a molecule, is this an atom? So it may even help to do that, but keep in mind that it's not clever to have an ideology in that case, but be sensitive. Just think about your future self when you decide how to structure a namespace. Just think about where you would look for that component when you are looking for it in a year and have to debug it. Where would you expect this code? And if you are yourself looking for a component and are looking longer than you expect, then later on think about, yeah, would there be a place where I would have found it much faster? Would there have been a better name for it? So talk to your colleagues afterwards and improve. I don't think there is a final structure that you can just use and everyone will be happy. So iterate, the next project will be better. That's all for presentational components. You may have noticed until now I did not talk about node types, flow query or things like that. Everything you have seen until now is at Zeitgeist done by the front-end department. So a back-end developer had probably helped set up the project, the Git repository, install Neos there, and install Monocle. But after that, the front-end department will create the style guide, will create the presentational components. And once this is done, once project managers have seen it, it will be handed back to the back-end department. And then we start thinking about what parts of this style guide shall be editable, which parts shall be presented to an editor, and which granularity an editor will have to use the elements we have created there. But it's a total different process. So now, patterns for the integration. First, some hidden secrets. Neos does, with all these inline editing features, does some kind of magic that is necessary to click into the site and just change things. And the first thing is, how does a node type and a Fusion prototype actually work together? When you're coming from the world where you just create a node type and a fluid template, you may think that it actually does not need a Fusion prototype in between, at least not in all cases. But that actually is not the case. There is some magic involved. And I think Christian Müller already showed this. But actually, whenever Fusion renders a node, it will look into the type of the node type and try to instantiate or evaluate a Fusion prototype which has the same name. If you did not write this node type, well, it is still there. There is some auto magic involved, and there is this mysterious prototype generator. And I strongly recommend to deactivate it. It's for one reason. It tries to be nice to you. It tries to give you the data just directly into your template to render it. But if you're using Fusion, it just avoids that you see half of the code that is currently active. So I suggest to deactivate the prototype generator for your node types that you are creating. I deactivate it usually for the whole component namespace of my project, but at least if you're creating your first prototype with AFX, you should disable it for that for this node type directly. After that, you have to access all props on your own, but you at least see the code. So, the prototype generator. And the third hidden secret, I think some of you know it, is how the inline editing in the Neos backend actually works. The Neos backend renders the content of the website in an iframe, but it adds some metadata. And this is an example from the new user interface. In the old user interface, this looks quite different. But the new user interface adds, or the old user interface adds metadata in the same places, but they look different. And there are two kinds of metadata that are usually rendered. The first one is the content element wrapping, and this one is applied whenever a node has to be referenced in any way. So be it a content collection, which you can select to add nodes into it, or be it a single content node, it is all wrapped in the content element wrapping. And this metadata is what makes Neos able to select this node, to show you the inspector properties, and to select the same node in the structure view when you click on it. The second part is the content editable wrapping, and this one is used if you want to edit a single property or a text inline. So there is also just a property key rendered and a reference to which nodes this property belongs to. Whenever you run into trouble with inline editing and you want to debug this, I suggest to look into the HTML, which is rendered into the content iframe in the backend, and to look after this this metadata, whether it is there and whether it contains values that make any sense. So, but now, content mapping. Content mapping is the process that, or is the way we call a process when you take node types and map the properties of the node types to the props of the presentation or components. And we usually separate our Fusion codebase into two parts. First, presentation, and this part we call integration, where we do all the domain-specific logic. So, first example. Render a node type and use a presentational component. Interesting part is here we do not use Neos Fusion component as base prototype for this Fusion prototype, and we use Neos content component. And what Neos content component is, it is a component together with content element wrapping. So what I mentioned before, the metadata that is needed, that you can actually select a section in the content iframe, that is added to the Neos content component. It's quite similar to the Neos content, but Neos content expects you to define a Fluor template. So Neos content component is a content node that is pure Fusion. If you want to map some properties of your node, which actually is almost always the case, you access these properties via Flow query, just quite simple. But it gets more interesting with the data that actually is metadata. So like, that is domain specific. So like an image, and if this node has a property image, it will return an asset item. And yeah, as I mentioned, you shall not pass domain data to presentational components. So we are using the Neos image URI prototype to convert the asset into an actual image URL, which is then passed to the presentational component. Same goes for the link property. The link usually will contain some node double colon slash slash, and if it is an actual link to some website, it's fine, but if it refers to a node or an asset, the presentational component does not have any clue to what to do with such a link. It will just render it, and in your front end you cannot do anything with it. So you have to add the processors which are expanding that, and at this place, so at process convert URIs, or if you want to interact with it in the backend, so if you want to avoid that if your editor clicks this item in the backend, that this link is actually there, you can use the addIf annotation there to suppress that this property is actually rendered in the backend. So in backend, link will always be null. Together with the pattern for the conditional tag I've shown before, this makes a nice editing experience for the editor. With that in place, we can have the properties of the nodes rendered with presentational components, but we want to have inline editability as well. And to do that, we have the Neos editable prototype. The editable prototype renders a tag with the metadata the Neos backend needs for the inline editing features. And you can pass it as the same prop to the same component. So it does not matter to this component whether you pass a static string or a property you fetched from a node type or a whole editable. It's a thing integration decides. The component is usable in all ways. So it's very important. Usually you would have multiple Fluid templates to have a thing editable, non-editable, and you would have a hard time to make them look the same, especially when you are changing things over time and have sometimes dozens of teaser templates, and some of them are editable, some not, and you expect them to look the same. Either gets a very complicated template, which is really hard to maintain, especially for front-end developers, since it contains so much back-end logic, or it gets just a bunch of templates, which is hard to maintain because there are so many templates that have to be kept in sync. In this case, you have a single teaser, and you can use it in multiple ways and decide in the integration whether there are some parts inline editable. So the editable prototype is a text that is only rendered in the backend with content editable wrapping applied. Still simple. Next thing is container mapping. And quite often you not only have props you want to render, you also have like accordion containers which can contain child nodes on their own and similar stuff. And for that we used to map containers. And the interesting thing here is that you can have, or that you have some Fusion prototypes that directly render the content of a node with all child nodes, so, or of a collection node. In this case, I use the Neos primary content, which expects a node path and will fetch all children from this node path and render it directly. So you can map this to a prop and pass it over to a presentational component. Now it gets more interesting. We want to map collections. When we have prototypes or presentational components that expect some more complex data structure, we can create that via mapping as well. In this example, I'm showing a slider node, which expects a prop slides, which is an array of items. And to actually map that, I use the Neos Fusion raw collection. And as a collection, I pass all child nodes which are of type slide, and use then the raw array to render the props for which are then which then represent each slide, and this data structure gets passed to the presentational component, which later on can use it. So quite easy, but we still do not have inline editability here. You probably will do not want to manage all the slides for the slider via structure view, but if I do it that way, I can easily create the data structure I need for my presentational component, but to be able to actually interfere with the child nodes, I have to do something else or something more. And this looks like this. If we think back, what do we need to interfere with a specific node in the Neos backend? And the thing we need is the content element wrapping. So we have to somehow apply content element wrapping to a component that does not know about it. So it's we have to use a trick here. And what we do is, in the first place, we add a reference to the node, to the raw array we are passing over to the component. I use the underscores here to make sure that this is kind of internal, so the presentational component will not care that there is an additional property in the rendered array. But the slide node is there. Time? Okay. And on the second slide, you can see that, or this is further down, you can see that this node is then used to apply content element wrapping to all items of the slide prototype which are rendered inside the slider. So that way you get the content element wrapping to the right places. You have to be careful with this pattern, but it's definitely possible. You can also extend this to pass editables. There, in this case, I also had to set the node property, since editable usually expects the node to be in the context variable node, which is not this case if I call it slide. So something special, but it's definitely possible to have inline editable features together with mapped content collections. So be careful with this pattern. It has problems in the old user interface. In the new user interface, it works just fine. And if you do it that way, you have also be careful to notify your editors about empty collections. So if the slider component or if the slider node type does not contain any children, you should say something to the editors in the classic way. When you create a content collection, the Neos backend will always render some information. You can put content here. If you do it that way with presentational components and a structured interface, you're responsible for that as well. And in this case, it would be the presentational component that would be responsible to display some helpful error message, or not error message, it's totally valid, but be responsible to help the editor. So that's all. Important, keep presentation and integration separated. If you run into trouble, there is a Slack channel where it's not that much traffic, but it's there a while, and I assume it's not that much traffic since there are not so many problems with Atomic Fusion. But if you run into trouble, get over there, and me or other people will try to help. Thank you.